turn to 250 in your hymnal, 250. There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Let's all stand together if you would. Stand as we sing that first. There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife, discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings, stirred the slumbering chords again.
Singing this morning. Welcome to the morning service on August 28, 828. I never think of 828, but I think of Romans 828. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. And I also remember 828 because it's Carol Hoskins' birthday on 828, isn't it? And don't bow your head, Carol. It's not time to pray, all right? She's And how great would it be born on 8/28? And remind yourself every day that all things work together for good to them that love God. And good to see you in church this morning. Looking forward to a great, great Sunday morning together. Thanks for making the time and being in your place today. Let's open with prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you, Lord, for another Lord's Day that you've given to us. And this is the day the Lord hath made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. And Lord, we commit the service into your hands this morning. We thank you, Lord, that we just sang that Jesus saves and that there's in my heart a melody. And Lord, where Jesus is the sweetest name I know. May he be exalted this morning. May you lift up Christ in our service today. And may all of us be drawn closer to him because we were in church this morning. Bless the music. Bless our fellowship together. Honor the preaching of the word of God. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
High upon a mountain from where he ascended, an angel of the Lord declared that it would be. He said, don't stand the grieving for the one that you see leaving. In like manner's coming back for you and me. I believe he's coming back like he said. And I believe that the trumpet's gonna sound so loud one day it'll wake the dead. In the twinkling of an eye, he'll split the eastern sky. And I believe he's coming back like he said. I believe that him leaving, we will soon disappearing, and this could be the hour, yes, this could be the day, when the saints from every nation will lose their gravitation in the middle of the air, be caught away. Said, I trumpet's gonna sound so loud. One day it'll wake the dead. In the twinkling of an eye, he'll split the eastern sky. And I believe he's coming back like he said. And I believe he's coming back like he said. I believe that the trumpet's gonna sound so loud. One day it'll wake the dead. In the twinkling of an eye, he'll split the eastern sky. And I believe he's coming back like he said.
Amen. Amen. Let's go to 231, if you would. 231. Down in the valley with my Savior I would go. Follow, follow one. 231. On that first together.
Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the flowers are blooming and the sweet waters flow. Everywhere he led me, I would follow, follow on, walking in his footsteps till the crown be won. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I would follow on. Follow. And the dark waters flow. With his hand to lead me, I will never, never fear. Danger cannot frighten me if my Lord is near. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I would follow on. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere he leads me, I will follow. Down in the valley or upon the mountain steep, close beside my Savior would my soul ever keep. He will lead me safely in the path that he has trod, up to where they gather on the hills of God. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I would follow on. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere he leads me, I will follow on.
All right. Well, a few announcements for us now. Listen carefully, if you will. We'll have our regular schedule. Today, 5:30 is our Christian growth class, and we meet in the conference room right at 5:30. And tonight, we'll talk about the place called hell. All right? Hell's a Bible doctrine. Just as sure as there's a heaven, there's also a hell. And it's not something that we enjoy talking about or maybe like to talk about, but it is a reality. And we're going to study what the Bible says about that this evening. 5:30 in the new for the new Christian class in the conference room. Then 6:30 tonight will be the evening service, all right? And the evening service, you come back tonight, I want to talk to you on the subject, let me look at your feet. Let me look at your feet, okay? You don't have to wear sandals or anything. We'll take care of that, but we'll see what the Bible says about that this evening, all right? And we'll have a good service together tonight. And then, reminder, the missionary cards are dwindling down. There's just a handful left, and if we could get those cleared out, it would be wonderful. So if you've not yet selected anything off the table there, why don't you see what the Lord would have you to do and see if we can get those all taken care of today. If you can at all possible, we'd like to have those gifts returned with the cards by next Sunday evening, which is September 4th. If you can't do that, then just see the ladies and tell them when you think you'll have it in, and I'm sure they'll make arrangements for that. That's okay. But just make sure that they're aware with what's going on. And if something has changed and you can't get what you thought you could get, just bring the card back, and they can put it on the table, and maybe the Lord will have someone else pick that up and take care of it. It's all right. okay? Grove City School of the Bible will begin Tuesday night, 7 o'clock. Those of you signed up for that, be in your place in the fellowship hall, 7 o'clock Tuesday evening for the Grove City School of the Bible. And ladies, don't forget, your night out is tomorrow night, and you're going bowling, all right? So meet here. Remember, 6:15 sharp right here at the church. Just a brief time of devotional, and then you get to the bowling alley and you get 2 hours of bowling, and just $7.50, and you'll have a great time. That's always a fun night. And sign up for that, though, downstairs. Need to give them a number by this evening, and so get your name on the list. And fellas, this is where you watch the kids and you let your wife come have a night out, okay? That's how that works, all right? So you do that, and if you have a problem with that, you see Bob Reed, he'll watch your kids for you. And isn't that what I was supposed to say, Bob? That wasn't what I was supposed to say. But it'll be a great time, always is for the ladies, okay? Now, let's take a moment, and we'll welcome our guests that are with us in the service. If you're visiting this morning and you're not a member here at Bible Baptist Church, or if you brought a guest with you, we'd love to meet you. Find out who you are and where you're from. And if you have a guest, just put your hand up this morning. Brother Chuck has a guest back here with him. Fantastic. Alicia, again, thank you for being here. Glad you're here. All right. And go ahead, Brian. And Bree is here with her children, I believe, and good to have her this morning. Jacqueline must be on nursery duty this morning, and good to have Bree with us today, and that's good. Anybody else for the first time here this morning? All right. Again, it's good to have Susan and Heather here, and they were in, of course, for Susan's mother's service yesterday, and that was a wonderful time, and just a full house, I'm telling you. Here and delightful to just been delighted to have them with us for a few days. They'll be heading back to is it Baltimore area, in that area, after service today, heading back there. And then when do you fly back to Japan, Susan? Wednesday morning. All right, so pray for safe travels for them as they go, and safety then for the flight on Wednesday as she gets back to her husband and her children and their church in Japan. And God's doing great things there. They just celebrated their first anniversary. And God's really doing some great things there, and bringing them good families, and reaching people for Christ. It's an exciting place to be. And I know she's excited to get back there. All right. Well, let's take a minute. Oh, we got to welcome our visitors, and we'll hear from the choir, right? Let's give our visitors a warm welcome, shall we?
Thank you.
191, 1911, upon life's billows you are tempest-tossed. Count your many blessings. Name them one by one. 191, on that first together. When upon life's billows you are tempest-tossed. When you are discouraged, thinking all is lost. Count your many blessings, name them one by one. And it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does a cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them. Amen. Kids, why don't you be dismissed to junior church. Children, you're dismissed to junior church. We'll sing that last together. So amid the conflict, whether great or small, on that last. So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged. God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend. Help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Amen. Great singing this morning. Let's go over to 91, if you would. What a day, what a glorious day that will be. Let's all stand together as we sing. There is coming a day when no heartaches shall come. There is coming a day when no heartaches shall come. No more clouds in the sky. No more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I looked upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. see. And I looked upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day. There'll be no parting there, no more burden to bear. Let's sing that last together. Did you find your seats? When we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out and sing that a cappella. On that last together, there'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there, and
a whole lot of that. Good singing. You may be seated. Boy, that's great. Won't that be what heaven will be like? Can you imagine just a few million people singing that? And wow. Just be amazing, amazing time. And there'll be no offerings in heaven. I'm glad you didn't say amen to that, but you have to send it on ahead, amen? And that's what we do. Lay up for ourselves treasure in heaven, and give as God has blessed you and prospered you, and you've been faithful in your giving through the summer. Appreciate that, and continue to give faithfully, and the Lord will honor your gifts. All right, let's pray. We'll ask God's blessing on our offering this morning. I don't know where the microphones are going. I guess I'll pray. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity for us to give, and we do ask, Lord, that you will bless the gift and giver alike here today. Lord, you know the needs of your work and this church, and I pray that you'll use the giving of your people to care for those needs and for the furtherance of the gospel through Bible Baptist Church. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. Take your Bible this morning, if you would, to the book of Joshua, Old Testament book of Joshua, and Joshua chapter 1, please. Joshua chapter 1. We're going to read the first two verses of Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, and we'll just read those in unison this morning. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word, and let's read verses 1 and 2 together on verse 1. Ready? Now, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel. And let's pray, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture here this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the Bible. Thank you, Father, for allowing us to have copies of your word in our hand this morning. And Lord, thank you so much for the wonderful music today. Lord, we've enjoyed singing praises to you. And thank you for the people of God in this place that love to sing, love the songs of God. Lord, I pray that you would bless the special now and that it would continue to minister to our hearts and that you'd prepare us for what you have for us from your word this morning. It's in Jesus' name that we ask it. Amen. Now, Father, we bow before you in prayer today, and Lord, again, we thank you already for the good service that we've enjoyed this morning. It's been good to be in the house of the Lord today. Father, I ask you now as we open up your word, and we want to hear from you this morning. We want to you to open our understanding as we look into the word of God today. And I pray, Lord, you take the truth this morning and use it to be a help, a challenge, and encouragement to each of us that are here this morning. So, Lord, help me as I bring the message today, and please help the folks as they listen, and Spirit of God, do what only you can do in every heart and life. And I pray and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. In the book of Joshua, it starts out with the death of Moses. He says, Moses, after the death of Moses, and then it says something interesting, the servant of the Lord. And it struck me one day as I was reading that, how God summed up the life of Moses, 120 years. And he gave a summary right there of Moses' life. Moses, the servant of the Lord. You know, how many of you enjoy going through cemeteries at times and reading the epitaphs on tombstones? Anybody like to do that? A lot of you do that. And some interesting, some are humorous. One of them had this on the tombstone. Here lies my wife, so let her lie. Now she is at rest, and so am I. Another one said, here lies hypochondriac Rick. For once he was right when he said he was sick. This one said, Maria has gone to the pearly gate. For once in her life, she won't be late. I remember years ago, Brother Yoder here in Curtis Hudson talk about this one. He said, he went through the cemetery, and I don't know if it's real or not, but he said, here lies the body of Mr. Pease, P-E-A-S, Mr. Pease. But he says, Pease is not here. This is just his pod. Pease has shelled out and gone home to God. That's a pretty good one. You might be able to guess some of these. These were some people put on there trying to reflect their life's work, what they did for a living. There's one that says, that's all, folks. That's not Bugs Bunny, by the way, okay? Mel Blanc, who did the voice of all those characters. That's what's on his tombstone. I got news for Mr. Blank, though. He found out that this is not all there is. She did it the hard way. That's the tombstone of Betty Davis. The entertainer, he did it all. That's the tombstone of Sammy Davis Jr. He thinketh no evil. That's the tombstone of Henry Ward Beecher, preacher. He thinketh no evil. The best is yet to come. That's on the tombstone of Frank Sinatra. I hope he meant that. I hope he, by the way, for the Christian, the best is yet to come. But if God gave people epitaphs in the Bible, and in certain cases, he did. And certainly here for Moses, he did. He said, Moses, my servant, or Moses, the servant of the Lord. He called Abraham the friend of God. He called Daniel greatly beloved. He called David a man after my own heart. And I want you to think this morning, if you would, just to yourself. Don't say anything out loud and don't elbow anybody. But what would God say if he summarized your life to this point? How would God put a summary on you and what you've done? And if you think about it, probably what Christian people would say about you, or those who are close to you would say about you, might be pretty accurate as to what God might say. But I want to look at a few today that God gave a summary of their life. And as we go through these, I want you to think about what God might say if he summarized your life. For one day, he will. And I wonder what he's going to say. You understand, we're writing our epitaph as we live. We're writing what's going on our tombstone right now. And we're certainly writing what God's going to say about us. In Joshua 1, and verses 1 and 2, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, then the Lord spoke unto Joshua. Notice what he said in verse 2, Moses, my servant, is dead. My servant. He could have said, Moses, my leader, for he was a great leader of the children of Israel, but he didn't say that. He didn't say, Moses, the man who delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt, but he didn't say that. Moses, the man who spoke to the rock and water gushed out enough for probably 2 million Jews to have water for themselves and their animals. Imagine how much water had to come out. There's, I think, in the greater Columbus area, there's just under 2 million. Down all the suburbs. You imagine how much water gets used to just take care of our needs? Let alone the animals that would need to be cared for. Moses, who marched up to Pharaoh and said, let my people go. He didn't say any of those things. Because he said, Moses, my servant. But Jesus said, if you're going to be the chief, if you're going to be the greatest, then you need to be a servant. That's opposite from what the world teaches us. We look, if you went to downtown and looked at the big buildings and you went in to see who was in charge of that operation or in charge of that business, you'd look for some fella who had some letters after his name. CEO, CFO, president, something like that. And you think, oh, he must be the big shot. And God says, the big shots in my eyes are the servants. Moses was my servant. Moses had incredible talents and ability. In fact, over in the book of Acts, chapter 7, Stephen brings his sermon and he tells a lot of the history of Israel. And in Acts 7, in verse 23, he said, verse 22, Stephen said this about Moses. Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was mighty in words and in deeds. Says he was learned. Listen, the best education of his day that he could have had, Moses had. It says here, interesting enough, in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, he was mighty in words and deeds. You remember what excuse Moses gave God when he couldn't go deliver? Remember what he said? I can't talk. You think that was the truth? Doesn't appear to be. Seemed to be he's making an excuse. Kind of like people do when they say, oh, I could never go out soul winning. I could never go out and witness. But boy, you sure can't talk about Ohio State football with anybody. You sure can't talk about things you're interested in but with anybody else. Why can't you talk about the Lord that way? Boy, that's quiet. See, it's really just an excuse, isn't it? He had talents. He had ability. He really was in line to be the next Pharaoh, the next ruler in Egypt. But God says the greatest of these is a servant. And you know, servants in the Bible came in twofold. You know, a servant would be one that would be owned by his master, a slave, if you will, and he would serve. But then there's another slave in the Bible that the Bible says they were free from their master, but they didn't want to go free. They wanted to stay with their master. They would be called not just a bond slave, but a slave that is of their own free will staying to serve. And that's what you and I are. We're not under obligation. Hey, you know what? You can serve Christ with your life, or you don't have to. You're free to do what you want. That's why how many know some people, you look at them and you think, why are they messing their life up like this? Huh? Yeah. You know why? We have a free choice to do that. God will allow you to mess your life up. And people do that. But here's the thing. We have a choice to serve Jesus Christ. And I am choosing to serve Jesus Christ with my life. That's a choice you make, a choice you decide that the talent and the ability that you have are going to be given to Jesus Christ. Free to do what I want, but what I want to do is serve Jesus Christ. You see, people who shy away from, well, if I believe like you believe, that once you're saved, you're always saved, then, man, you can just live any way you want. You can just go out and sin all you want. Yeah, but here's the problem. You don't want to. Look at Titus chapter 2, will you please? Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2. First Timothy, 2 Timothy, and then Titus. Titus 2. Notice what verse 11 says. Titus 2:11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared unto all men. Now, the grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared to all men. For by grace are ye saved through faith. All right? So it's grace. But what does grace teach us? See, people say, oh, you're saved by grace and you're kept by the grace of God and you don't have to do anything to keep your salvation. Man, you'll just live loose, man. You'll just do anything you want. No, wait, what's it say? The grace of God teaches us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly. That's not just not drunkenly, but it's seriously. Soberly, righteously, and godly when? In this present world. Saved by the grace of God teaches me that I deny ungodliness, I deny the worldly lusts, I don't want to do those things. I have a desire to please God. I drank every time I wanted to yesterday. I drank alcohol every time I wanted to. You know how much alcohol I drank? I didn't drink any. I don't want to. I cursed and swore any time I wanted to yesterday. You know how often I cursed and swore? I didn't. I don't want to curse and swear anymore. You see, when you get saved by the grace of God, He changes your wanter. And the things I used to do, I don't want to do them anymore. You see, there's been a great change since I've been born again. And I have a desire to serve Jesus Christ. Nobody held a gun to your head and say, it's Sunday, get to church. Now, some of your kids may feel that way. But you know what? You're here because you had a desire to come to church. That's a good indication that you're a child of God. When you desire to be around the people of God and you desire to be around the songs of God, you desire to come and hear the Word of God. Those are good desires. The devil certainly isn't going to encourage you to do that. See? So choose to be a servant. I want to serve Jesus Christ. I don't know, it wouldn't be bad on your tombstone just to put the servant of the Lord. The servant of the Lord. That's pretty good. But you're in the New Testament. If you went to Titus, go a little bit to your right. Right after Titus is Hebrews, and right after Hebrews is the book of James. And look at James chapter 2. James chapter 2. James 2, notice with me verse 23. And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called, what? The friend of God. Huh. The friend of God. As far as I know, the only one in the Bible that was called that. It's an amazing thing. You know, you talk to your friends differently than you do people that you don't know very well. You agree? If you're meeting somebody for an appointment and they end up coming about 10 minutes late, oh, I'm sorry I'm late. Boy, I got held up. Man, I'm so sorry. I got here as soon as I could. What do you say to them? That's okay. It's all right. We're okay. We'll be all right. I'm glad you made it. But if I'm supposed to meet Andy at 1 o'clock and he doesn't show up till 10 after 1, I'll say, come on, man. Think I got nothing better to do all day than wait on you? Man, time's wasting. What, where you been? See, why? Because we're friends. Well, we used to be. Huh? Yeah, you just talk differently to friends than what you do to people you're not very well acquainted with. You know, I remember Dr. John R. Rice talking about prayer. And a man, he taught on prayer one time in a meeting, and a man came up to rebuke him, Brother Moreland, because Dr. Rice, he prayed to the Holy Spirit, he prayed to Jesus, he said, Dr. Rice says, we pray to God through the Spirit in the name of the Son. That's how prayer is to be made. Dr. Rice had glasses, and he always took them, went down like that, or else he put his in as he chew on it. He looked down at that guy and he said, son, when you've been in the family as long as I have, you can talk to anybody you want, anytime you want. And I like that. And that's true. You can talk to any God the Father, God the Son, or God the Holy Spirit. Now listen. It's wonderful to have friends. But it's infinitely more important that you be a friend. If all you focus on is whether I have friends, you're going to live a very frustrated life. You need to focus on being a friend. And that's the important thing. And let me say this. A friend is always a friend. A friend is always a friend. We may throw that term around a little too loosely when it comes to how many friends you got. Oh, well, Pastor, I got 1,000 friends on Facebook. That's not a friend. Sorry to disappoint you. The Bible says a friend loveth at all times. A friend loveth at all times. That simply means, listen, if a friend has a need, then I have a need. If a friend has a problem, then I have a problem. If I have a dollar, my friend has a dollar. A friend loveth at all times. You heard about the two farmers that were friends. He said, Bill, if you had 100 cows, would you give one to me? He said, sure I would, George. You know I would. You're my friend. Well, Bill, if you had 50 chickens, would you give one to me? He said, well, sure I would, Bill. You're my friend. He said, well, if you had 10 sheep, would you give one to me? He said, well, Bill, you know I would. You're my friend. He said, well, what if you had 2 pigs? Would you give one of them to me? He said, now, wait a minute. You know I got 2 pigs. What a friend. The Bible says that if I'm the friend of God, if I'm not the friend of God, then I'm the friend of the world. And it says if I'm the friend of God, the enemy of the world. So I can't have it both ways. You say, well, I want to love God, I want to be a friend of God, and I want the world to think I'm cool. It won't happen. It won't happen. If the world is your friend and they think you're cool, you're not the friend of God. That's not me, that's James. You look it up, James 4, verse 4. That's the world's system, the world's philosophy, the world's outlook on life, which is opposite of the way God views things. So when I stand with God and I love Him at all times, then I can be the friend of God. That's what Abraham was. So if he summarized Moses' life, he said, Moses, my servant. He summarized Abraham's life and he said, Abraham is the friend of God. There's a third one I want you to look at today. It's in the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 10. Daniel's toward the end of the Old Testament. You get through the longer book of Ezekiel, and right after Ezekiel is the book of Daniel. And look at chapter 10 of Daniel. God's summary of your life. Daniel chapter 10. Verse number 10 says, and behold, a hand touched me, which set me upon my knees and upon the palms of my hands. And he said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto thee, and stand upright, for unto thee am I now sent. And when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling. And he gets a message from God. Verse 11, he says, you're a man greatly beloved. Now we think of Daniel as a man of courage, and he was. A man who took a stand, and he did. A man who prayed, whether you were allowed to pray or not allowed to pray. Daniel was a man of conviction and courage. When no one else would, when everyone else would eat the king's meat and drink the king's drink, Daniel said, I'm not going to do that. And he got three of his friends to go along with him. Out of the hundreds, if not thousands of young men that were taken captive during that period of time and taken into Babylon to be trained to serve in the king's palace. So Daniel not only prayed once a day, he prayed three times a day, and he prayed with his window open. And when they passed the law and they passed a decree saying you can't pray anymore, he went and did just like he always did. And by the way, he didn't even close the window. He prayed for the open window. That's what he always did. And by the way, he didn't start praying when they passed the law, say you couldn't. He just kept doing what he always was doing. Okay? Well, it'd be interesting to know. It'd be interesting, wouldn't it, how many folks have come out soul winning and come out to visitation if they passed a law saying you weren't allowed to do it? Oh, bless God, that take away our liberty. We can't witness. What are they talking about? Yeah, but when you have that liberty and you have that freedom, are you taking advantage of it? It's real quiet in here sometimes. How many know the song Dare to Be a Daniel? Huh? That's one we don't sing a lot. I found it the other day. Standing by a purpose true, heeding God's command. Honor them, the faithful few. All hail to Daniel's band. Dare to be a Daniel. Dare to stand alone. Dare to have a purpose firm. Dare to make it known. Daniel, what a great man. And you think of Daniel who stood, and Daniel, when everybody else was compromising, Daniel said, I'll not compromise. I know everybody else is doing it, but I'm not going to do it. I'm going to remain true to God. I'm going to remain true to what I was brought up, true to what I was taught. I'm not going to go the way of everybody else. I'm not going to, in Babylon, do as the Babylonians do. I'm going to do as those who believe in God do. And listen, we're in a world that is sliding towards hell and sliding down the slippery slope, and we're not to slide with it. We're to take our stand, and when we take our stand and say, God is my judge, and I'm going to be true to God, and I'm going to do what God wants me to do, and I'm going to do what's right in God's sight, and I'm going to live pleasing to Him, God looks down and says, you're greatly beloved. You're greatly beloved. Daniel, stand alone if need be. Don't compromise. Stand alone at your job if you need to. Stand alone at school if you need to. Stand alone in the neighborhood if you need to. You'll be beloved by God. That's what he said about Daniel. Greatly beloved. And then in Acts 13, verse number 22, we have someone else mentioned. Acts 13 and verse 22. Moses, my servant, Abraham, my friend, Daniel, greatly beloved, Acts 13 and verse 22. And when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. A man after God's own heart. When Israel chose their first king, who did they choose? Saul. Why did they choose Saul? What? Yeah. Outward appearance. He was head and shoulders above everybody. He's the biggest guy around. Okay, let's choose him. He's intimidating. And he was, it wasn't that he was a real outgoing, charismatic kind of guy. When they went to get him to anoint him, where was he? Hiding. He was hiding in the stuff, the baggage. He didn't really want the job. But because he was big, it's like you know, you're choosing up teams for the basketball game, you know what I mean? And because the guy's 6'5", you say, yeah, well, I think we want him. And then you find out he can't chew gum and dribble at the same time, you know, and you think, oh, boy, wasted that pick. But Saul was just, they just did on outward appearance. Now, you know what happened to Saul. He didn't have the character. He didn't have the love for God he should have. And he ended up, God taking the kingdom from him. And God says, now, Samuel, I choose the next one. And you're going to go to the house of Jesse. And you're going to anoint one of the sons of Jesse to be the next king. But Samuel, don't look on the outward appearance. God says, I'm not looking on the outward appearance, I'm looking at his heart. You remember Samuel going, and Samuel, though he had that admonition from the Lord, it still was a tough thing for him to do. Because you recall, as the sons came, he would see Eliab, he would see some of the older boys, and boy, he thought to himself, surely, this is the Lord's anointed. Look at this guy, what a specimen. I bet he could bench 300. And he just looks like a great guy. This got to be the one. And the Lord said, no, 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 no. And finally, they went through all the boys that were there, and Samuel was kind of a little bit puzzled, and so he looked at Jesse, and what did he ask him? Don't you got any more boys? Well, I got one. He's out with the sheep. And I'm sure Jesse, if we could read his mind, he thought, you couldn't be thwarting David. Oh, well, go get him. I'm not leaving. You go get him. And here come David in, and the Bible says he was kind of ruddy looking and just not much. You wouldn't have looked at him and said, well, there's a boy who's really going places. But you know what God told Samuel? There's my man. There's my guy right there. David had a real mixture of toughness and tenderness. David talked about, before he killed Goliath, remember? He said, hey, I took care of a lion and a bear when they threatened the sheep. And that guy will be no different than them. Now, I don't know about you, but I kind of think when you don't have a gun and you kill a lion and a bear, you're pretty tough. If you want to be tough in my book, kill a lion and a bear. I would put you underneath definition tough. Okay? And you say, well, I did use a stone and a slingshot. Okay, you're still tough. Okay, I won't argue with you. He was tough, but wait a minute. But he also played the harp and was a psalmist and would sing psalms and write poems. That's pretty tender. He would consider the heavens, the works of his hands, and the sun and the moon and the stars which you've made. What is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visitest him? What a combination of toughness and tenderness that David was. Courageous, yet very compassionate. Tough and yet tender. We talked a couple Sunday mornings ago in Sunday school, I believe, about how David never sought vengeance. He had opportunity to really, really lash out at people. And as the king, could have taken their life, but he never did. Because I believe it's important that he was a man after God's own heart. We see that those characteristics in God. We see that he's God is tender and he's tough. God is love, but God is judgment. He has the perfect balance in all those areas. That's what David exhibited. That's what David showed. And so you find out from David, he's a man after God's own heart. Let's look at one more this morning. Go to the book of Job. It's really a fascinating study. You could probably have dozens of these. You go through the Bible on your own. Job 1. Job chapter 1. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was perfect and upright, one that feared God and eschewed evil. Job here is called perfect and upright. And it doesn't mean that he was sinless. It does mean that he walked right and he lives right. Now, I want you to notice something. Verse number 7. The Lord said unto Satan, whence comest thou? Satan answered the Lord, from going to and fro in the earth and walking up and down in it. Verse 8, and the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there's none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? That's when the devil says, oh yeah? You just put a hedge around about him. Let me at him, and he'll curse you to your face. But how did all that start? We always talk about all the stuff that happened to Job. But how did all that start? Why did Satan do that to him? Who brought it up? God did. Satan didn't come to God and say, hey, you think Job's so hot? Let me at him. No, God asked Satan, have you considered my servant Job? That's an amazing thing. What if God brought your name up? Would you be saying, no! Don't it, no! I don't want that. Would God even say, have you considered your name? Would you like God to bring your name up to Satan? Have you considered your name? Lived the way God wanted to live, so much so that God held him up for an example. By the way, Job proved true to what God said. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. What would God say in your tombstone? What would God write as your epitaph? How would God summarize your life this morning? Would it be Joe, the rebellious one? Would it be Sue, the talebearer? Would it be Mark, the lazy one, or Henrietta, the loose-tongued gossiper? John, the worldly one, or how would God summarize your life? Would it be faithful? Would it be kind? Would it be others? Would it be servant? Would it be friend? Would it be greatly beloved? Would it be perfect and upright? How would God summarize your life? Can I tell you this morning, if you're here and you've never received Jesus Christ as your Savior, God would summarize your life with one word. You know what it'd be? Lost. L-O-S-T. There's only really two kinds of people in the world. Those that are, what the Bible says, saved, and those are lost without Jesus Christ in the world. And the way you change that around is you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. And then you're no longer lost. You're no longer on your way to hell. You're on your way to heaven. You have to change that around by putting your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior. That's the only way for you to be saved. But if the Lord tarries, one day they'll put you in a box and they'll lower you 6 feet into the ground. They'll throw dirt on top of that box. And then they'll put a marker on top of that grave. It'll have your name on it, and it'll have your date of birth and the date of your death. And then it'll have something there that may say something about your life. what will it say? What will your loved ones think to put to summarize your life? You walk through the cemetery and you read those now, and you realize nobody in there can change what's already on their tombstone. But you know what? You and I can. We can change what's going to be on ours, because we're still writing it right now. If you don't like, if you say, man, I don't like, I think I like what they might put on mine, why don't you do something about it now? Why don't you begin to change now? And so live your life that they can put a summary of your life on there that would be pleasing to God and honoring to Him. For one day, the Bible says, every one of us will give account of himself to God. What will He say? What will He say? You know, I mentioned yesterday at the funeral, at the memorial service, that Ecclesiastes says that it's better, the day of one's, it's better to go to the house of mourning than to the house of feasting. That the day of your death is better than the day of your birth. It's a pretty phenomenal statement. But he says that we go to the house of mourning, we learn more there because we consider what's going on. I don't know about you, but I never go to a funeral, never conduct a funeral, but I don't think that someday it's going to be mine. Someday they'll gather and it'll be me. Someday they'll gather and it'll be you. What will be the summary of your life? What will God say about you? If it's not what you'd like it to be, ask God by His grace to help you do something about it. And I'd like to be one of those greatly beloved or friend of God or man after God's own heart, or, hey, you know what? My servant. I like that. What would you like to have on yours? Most importantly, you want to have saved on yours. Let's bow for prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, I thank You for this morning. Thank You, Lord, for Your Word. Thank You, God, for putting these men in the Bible and for giving us Your summary of their life. Lord, we realize, we all know that if You tarry Your coming, we're going to die. And not only will there be people here that'll summarize our life, we realize when we stand before You, You'll put a summary of our life as well. If I heard, well done, thou good and faithful servant, I'd be thrilled. Lord, today I pray You'd put it into the hearts of Your people who know Christ as their Savior, who are to live their lives not to themselves, but unto one who loved them and gave Himself for them. To think about how You would summarize their life. Help us, Lord, not to desire to succeed at something that will not matter for eternity. I pray You've spoken to hearts this morning. And I pray, Lord, if any in this room today are not saved, they would have to say, you know, I've never accepted Christ as my Savior. I'm lost. I need to be saved. That they would call on Jesus Christ this morning and ask Him to be their Savior. Now our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'm going to finish the prayer in just a moment. But I wonder right now, just between you and God, I wonder how many people this morning would say, Pastor, there's a time in my life when I called on Jesus and I asked Him to be my Savior, and Pastor, I know that I'm saved. I know that at least that part is taken care of. I know that I'm going to heaven when I die. Pastor, here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip it up for a moment that I may see it? Pastor, I know that I'm saved. All right, you may put them down. You're here this morning and say, well, Pastor, I'd probably be under that other category. L-O-S-T, I'm lost, I don't know. where I'd go when I'll die. I don't know if I'd go to heaven or hell. But would you allow me to pray for you? It's the most important decision you ever make in your life, where you'll spend eternity. I'd like to pray for you this morning. Nobody embarrass you. No one will call you out. But I sure would pray for you to the Lord. You say, Pastor, I'm not sure this morning about my eternity. Would you pray for me? Would you slip your hand up and put it back down that I'll see it? Anybody like that? You couldn't raise it the first time, but you raise it this time. Anybody here like that? Let me pray for you. The message was to believers today. I wonder how many believers here this morning could say, Pastor, I'm not real pleased with what might be the summary of my life to this point, that God might say, but by His grace, I'm going to do something about that today. And I'm going to live the rest of my life thinking about how would God summarize my life? What would God write on my tombstone? And I want to be one of those that would be His servant or greatly beloved or a man after God's heart, woman after God's heart. Faithful, loving, kind, others. Say, Preacher, the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart this morning, and I appreciate you praying for me today. Would you slip your hand up, Christian? Say, pray for me, Pastor. Yes. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may put them down. In a moment, I'm going to pray, and we'll have our invitation. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him today, will you? Do what God is telling you to do. If you're here today and you've never received Christ your Savior, when others are coming to pray, just slip from your seat. Come down to the front. We have people that have been trained. They'll take a Bible, and they'll show you how you can know Jesus Christ as your Savior. You can walk out the door this morning knowing you have eternal life, knowing you're on your way to heaven. If you're here today and you're saved and you've never been scripturally baptized, you ought to say, Pastor, I've accepted Christ, and I need to obey Him in baptism this morning. If you're saved and you're scripturally baptized and you believe this is the place you ought to belong, and say, Preacher, we want to belong here. We want to serve the Lord here. We want to make Bible Baptist Church our home church. Then you come. We'll be glad to receive you into our fellowship. Whatever it is that God's spoken to your heart about it, obey Him this morning. Father, have your way in this invitation now. I thank you for speaking to hearts this morning. Thank you, God, for hands that have been uplifted. Thank you, Lord, for people who are responsive to what the Spirit of God speaks to their heart about. And I pray that your will be done now in each heart and life, that each one will respond and do what you're telling them to do. Lord, I pray you'd help those who maybe need to be saved or need to make a profession of their faith or need to come for baptism, and just Christians who want to kneel and say, God, I want my life to count for you. I want to impact others with my life. Lord, I pray you'd help them to come and bow the knee to you this morning. May your will be done in these next few moments, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart this morning. Respond to Him, will you?
All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him. In His presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender. Humbly at His feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior. Jesus, I surrender. Make me, Savior, wholly thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. I surrender all, I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
Ask that you will give us a good afternoon and prepare us for the services this evening. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. Thank you for each one that's made their way here today. Now, God, I pray you'd make us mindful of your presence as we leave this place. I pray, Lord, that we would honor you and this truly would be the Lord's day. We love you. Thank you for meeting with us this morning. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, look forward to seeing you tonight, 5:30 for the Christian Growth Class, and 6:30, of course, for the evening service right back here, and we'll look forward to a great time together tonight. Remember, if you can look over the cards that are left, if you want to pick some of those up, if you haven't got any yet, please be a blessing to our missionaries. I'm excited about the ones that are coming, and there's some things there that you might be able to pick up still. If the Lord touches your heart about it, please do that. Just talk to the ladies there, and they'll help you out, and remember, the Bible school starts Tuesday evening. Those of you on that list, don't forget that. Ladies, sign up for the bowling, and you'll have a great time tomorrow night. Okay? Brother Bob, lead us in our closing song. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You're dismissed. We'll see you tonight.